Alright, in this video, what we're going to do is we're going to begin a series of discussions that talk about electric circuits. Now, what we're going to work with today is we're going to just look at, or in this video, is we're just going to look at simple circuits to begin with. But the ideas that we develop in this video will be very important in all of the other videos that we talk about. So it's really important that you get a strong foundation here so that as we move forward, you can stay rock solid in what we're talking about. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to kind of do something a little different. We're going to work back and forth. As you can see here, we've got the opening table here. We're going to build some circuits on this so that you can kind of see what's going on there. And then a little later on, we'll transition back to the larger board where I can maybe do some extra explanation. So if we look at the simple circuit, what we're going to do is we're going to build a circuit for you here to try to give you a sense of what we're actually going to be looking at. Now, when we build a circuit, what you'll oftentimes notice is that in circuit diagrams, actual physical objects are given symbols so that somebody who knows how to read a circuit diagram can actually sort of very quickly see what's going on. So what I've lined out here is the idea of a simple circuit. A simple circuit has one power supply, in most cases this will be something like a battery or a generator. Those are always represented by a series of alternating long and short lines, with the long lines being positive and the short lines being negative. In the case of this, what we're going to use is we're going to use a fairly simple battery pack that goes right here. This will be the positive end, that'll be the negative end, and we'll have three D-cell batteries hooked positive to negative in what we would call a specific type of arrangement we call a series arrangement. Now, what we're then going to do is we're going to connect that with some wires to some other things. We're going to go ahead and wire up a switch. The point of the switch is it allows us to turn the circuit on and off. This is a single pole tap switch. Okay, so this is not quite like the switch that you have in your wall where once you turn the switch up, it's always in the on position and then you have to flip it to the off position. This, you have to actively hold it down, allows us to save our batteries a little bit. Okay, we'll then hook that up to a simple light bulb. Now, notice we've got our light bulb in a circle with sort of a filament in there. This is what we call an incandescent light bulb. It works on a slightly different set of physical properties and principles than say the fluorescent light bulbs in a classroom, or those compact fluorescent light bulbs or LED light bulbs that you're beginning to see show up in your household. This has got a filament inside of an evacuated glass envelope or chamber that is the light bulb itself. So we're going to hook up to that. Finally, what we'll do is we'll go from the other end of the light bulb back to the negative end of our battery. Now notice, by the way, this holder actually holds our light bulb in. We can say that this metal piece here makes contact with one end of the filament inside the light bulb. The other metal piece makes contact with the other end of the light bulb. So what you'll notice here is I've got everything wired up so that there's a complete path all the way through the circuit. And that's the condition for there to be a complete circuit, is there must be a complete unbroken path that's continuous. Now in this case, that's not the case, because if you'll notice, the switch here is in the open or unconnected position. So if I push the switch down, what you'll notice is the light bulb turns on. Okay? If I let the switch up, the light bulb turns off. So notice that when I complete the circuit by pressing this piece of metal to that piece of metal so that there's a complete path uninterrupted through the switch, we get the flow of electricity through the light bulb. Okay, so that's the key idea on a simple circuit, is you have one power supply, in this case the battery pack, and you have one thing that uses up that power, in this case the light bulb. The switch just allows us to open and close the circuit. If we wanted to, we could easily take the switch out. If we just connect the two wires together here, if I can get that to go, notice taking the switch out, the light bulb lights all the time. So what the switch allows us to do, like I say, is to open and close the circuit in such a way that we can turn things on and off. And this is very similar to the type of switch that you use in your walls at home to turn your lights on and off. Okay? So that's the first thing to understand about a simple circuit. So notice we've got wires. Those are represented in our circuit diagram by just simple lines. We've got a power supply. We've got a light bulb. All right, so now let's go ahead and talk about some of the things that we want to kind of use as tools to help us understand what's going on in the simple circuit. So I'm going to go to the big board here. All right, there are a couple of terms that we have to be very, very clear to define. And the one of these terms you may not have seen before. The other term, if you've been working up to this point in circuits, you're already familiar with, but we'll define a little bit. The first is what we call current. Now, what you should understand here is the current is a fluid flow term, and that's because all of the original models for electricity, it was thought that what happened is in the wires of the circuit, there was a fluid that actually moved, okay? It's Ben Franklin's the first guy to do good work on this, as we've talked about before, and what Ben Franklin said was it was a fluid moving through the wires, okay? So what we now know is that this is the movement of electric charge through a medium. Okay? That's what current is. It's the movement of electric charge through the medium or any given medium. Now, when we're talking about the type of circuit that we've looked at here, the medium are the wires. Is the metal itself and the wires. That turns out that is a conducting material that allows for the movement of electric charges. The type of electric charge moving in the medium are electrons. Okay, if you remember your model of the atom, you know the model of the atom. You have electrons that orbit around the nucleus of the atom. In a metal, one or more of those electrons is sort of donated to what we call electron gas. And those electrons are allowed to move freely through that conducting material, through that metal, okay? Now, in other types of physical systems, those electric charges may be something different. They may be, say, in a battery, you may have the movement both of electrons and positively charged ions through a fluid, okay? And that's what's going to happen in, say, a car battery or, you know, a wet cell battery, that sort of thing. In a semiconductor, say, in your computer, what you're going to have is you're going to have positively charged quantum mechanical holes moving through the doped material in the semiconductor. Okay, so a lot of different ways in which this can happen. For now, what we want to understand is when Ben Franklin first did this, Ben Franklin had to guess as to what kind of fluid. He said there were two kinds of charges. Okay, it was positive and negative, and he didn't know which one was moving. So Ben Franklin says, well, I'm just going to make a wild guess at it, and I'm going to assume it's the positive charge moving through the medium. So when we talk about a simple circuit like this, when we close the switch, what Ben Franklin said is that there was a positively charged current moving everywhere in the circuit. Okay? Everywhere in the circuit. Now, what you'll notice is I used arrows here to sort of represent that. That's a good physical representation in a circuit, is to draw your arrows in the direction of positive, what we call conventional current flow. And in drawing those arrows that way, what you want to do is the length of the arrow tells you how much current you have to flow. Now what you'll notice, and you can actually sit down and do measurements to sort of confirm this, and that is you will find that these arrows will all be the same length. Now, this is really shocking for a lot of students, but if you've done some of the experimental work that we do in my class, what you can show is, in this case, all of these arrows should be the same length. In other words, the light bulb is not using up current. It is using something up, but it is not current, okay? Because if it was using up current, what we would see is electric charge spraying out of the light bulb. What you could do is you could hold your hand up near the light bulb, and your hand would get all staticky just by holding it up next to the light bulb. So what we know is that we are conserving electric charge. We're not using it up anywhere in the circuit. Okay? So the question might be, what is it that we're actually using up in the circuit? Okay. Well, what you're actually using up goes back to the second term we want to define, and we've talked about this in a previous video, and that is the idea of what you call voltage or electrostatic, what we call electrostatic potential. Now, what this is a way of measuring the amount of energy available to an electric charge as it moves through the circuit. Okay? So, what we're going to say is when we talk about a battery having a voltage, we said our batteries and our circuit that we built here, these were 1.5 volt D-cell batteries that we sort of put stacked one on top of the other, so this had a voltage of 4.5 volts. What that's telling us is when we say that battery has a voltage of 4.5 volts, is that that's how much, or a measurement of how much energy is available to the electric charges of the system. When you plug something into your wall outlet at home, and that's measured as a 120 volt wall socket, well, that again tells you that how much energy is available, or it's a measurement of how much energy is available to an electric charge in a circuit that's hooked up to that. So, what it turns out we're using up here is, we know that the light bulb, when we complete the circuit, gives off light. And what we know is light is a form of energy. All right. So, what the light bulb's using up isn't current, it's using up energy, which means that the battery gives an electric charge energy, and then the light bulb uses that energy up. Okay? And what it does is it specifically converts that electrical or electrostatic potential energy that the battery is giving the charge, it converts that into, in an incandescent bulb, it converts it into light energy and heat. Okay? Those, and actually it's all light energy. So, what we have here is we're still conserving energy, it's just the system of the circuit loses energy, and as it gets converted into energy that's thrown out. Okay? So, that's why we say current is not used up, but voltage can be given and then used to do or be turned into some other kind of work later on. One way to sort of see how that works is to look at a voltage diagram for a circuit. Okay, so if we take our circuit and we unpack it here, what we can kind of see here is if I take this being, say, a spot right there, and I open the circuit up, and then here's my light bulb. What we're going to say is that if I start here and I walk my way around this, if I'm an electric charge, is I start out with no energy at that point, I hit the battery, and the battery gives me a whole bunch of energy. How much? It's going to be 4.5 volts. So this is voltage on this axis. And then as long as I move through the ideal wire, there's no change in voltage. But once I hit that battery, or that light bulb right there, that light bulb uses up all 4.5 volts, is what we call the change in voltage for the light bulb. Okay? And it turns out I'm going to lose 4.5 volts there. I gain 4.5 volts going through the battery. I lose the 4.5 volts going through the light bulb. I come back and I have the same amount of energy as I started when I get to that point on the ending. Now we'll come back in a later video and we'll be very specific about this. This is one of Kirchhoff's laws. Okay, and it has to do with conservation of energy. Turns out, if I didn't use up more energy, I just get more current flowing. Okay, if I ran out of energy too soon, I would have less current flowing. And the way the circuit knows how much electricity, how much current to have flow is by establishing an electric field throughout the entire circuit that determines how electrons everywhere in the circuit are going to move. Okay. So that's how that actually works. Now, so early on, as they started doing work on this, a guy by the name of George Ohm was one of the first guys to actually sit down and try to do some things here that were, quantitative. And what George Ohm found out was, in these kinds of simple circuits, there was a very simple relationship that governed the relationship between the current flowing through a circuit and how the voltage changed. And so that relationship we call Ohm's law, okay, because George Ohm, this is the guy that figured it out, and as we've talked about before, this is a law, not a theory, so he's not working out why all of this works. He just recognizes this is what happens in most types of circuits, and he shows that across that light bulb, the change in voltage is equal to the current, I, that's the symbol we use for current, so if you'd like, that's I, and this would be change in voltage here, is equal to the current times this thing that he calls resistance. And this is the property of an object to resist the flow of electricity through the object. Okay, so it's the property of an object to resist the flow of electricity through the object. Now, turns out this depends on the material makeup of the object. The tungsten filament in our light bulb, given how long it is and all of that, gives us a specific resistance for that tungsten filament. Okay? If you do this for something else, say for a gold filament or a silver filament or copper or whatever, they're going to have different numbers. Okay? So that's a property of the object. Now, one of the things that makes this tough is most things that have resistance, the amount of resistance they have changes depending on how hot they are. Usually the hotter you get, the less resistance you're going to have. But there are many materials, and we call these things ohmic resistors, that actually their resistance doesn't change very much as long as you operate within a certain temperature range. And so this law works very nicely for those kinds of things. So if you've ever seen a circuit board, say from your computer or your phone or whatever, you'll see small cylinders that are soldered onto the circuit board and then right on there. Those small cylinders, a lot of those guys are going to be ohmic resistors. That's why they tell you you can only operate your electronic device within a certain temperature window or a certain temperature range. Because once you get out of that range, the resistance of those resistors starts to change. Now, when we want to talk about how bright the bulb is going to get, the final thing we want to mention in this video is what we call power. Now, what you will remember from what we talked about first semester is power is the amount of energy used up in a given amount of time. Okay? And that's in watts. Now, it turns out if you do some math here, you know, and I'll leave that as an exercise for the viewer, and that is, we can show that this power can be represented by some symbols that we already have. So, by the way, when we talk about change in voltage here, we usually say that's change in voltage across the resistor, and this is current through the resistor. That's really important. This law only works for a given resistor. In this case, it would be our light bulb. If I have multiple resistors, I can't just apply it to all the resistors willy-nilly. I have to specifically apply it to a specific given resistor. Same is true for the relationship we're about to have, and that is the power used up or created by a circuit element will be equal to the current through that circuit element times the change in voltage of that circuit element. Okay? So, that being the case, what you can say here is that this resistor uses up power. It's going to use up how much power? Well, it's going to be however much current is moving through the resistor times the change in voltage through the resistor. So, in this case, if I had 2 amps of current moving through our resistor, and my change in voltage across the resistor is 4.5 volts, 2 amps times 4.5 volts would give me 9 watts of power. So when we talk about a 60 watt light bulb, okay, you're talking about 120 volts, a 60 watt light bulb. If I take 60 divided by 120, you find that you have about a half an amp of current running through that light bulb. Okay, that's what's going on with that. Okay, that's how you can use this. The other thing we could also do is we can calculate how much power the battery is producing. Okay. So, this will give us a good sort of discussion place to start. We're going to take some time here in a minute in the next video to develop a couple of very useful models, because one of the things that's really tough about this is in trying to understand what you can't see other than this light bulb lighting up. We're going to try to build a couple of models in the next video that we can use going forward to help us to understand what we're seeing in terms that maybe are a little bit easier to understand, at least initially, than what we're saying up here on the board. But this gets us started. So if you've got a book or you want to go out to some websites and do some research on this, this hopefully gives you some terms to work with. Hang in there and keep working.